Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome, everyone. I want to thank you all for coming out this afternoon. My name is Tom Seguin, and I am the 2013 chair of the Manatee Chamber, and I own Suncoast Gem Lab. That's my day job. Chamber's my other day job. At this point, I'd like to ask you to please take a moment, turn off your cell phones, and join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. At this point, I'd like to recognize our elected officials and dignitaries. Today we have Manatee County Commissioner Betsy Banak. We have Manatee County Commissioner Larry Bussell, Manatee County Commissioner John Chappie, Manatee County Commissioner Robert DiSabatino, Manatee County Commissioner Michael Gallen, and we have Manatee County Commissioner Carol Whitmore. Oh. That's the commissioners. We have from the Manatee County School Board, Karen Carpenter. And from the City of Bradenton, we have Councilman Patrick Roth. And a couple who could not make it with us today. But anyway, let's give them all a welcome. At this point, I'd like to give a special thanks to our sponsors, Kaiser University and the Mosaic Company. Thank you very much for your sponsorship today. And of course, a big thank you to Charles Clapsaddle and his staff at METV. Thank you all very much. Our speaker today is our new superintendent of Manatee County Schools, Rick Mills. Rick W. Mills has a diverse and distinguished background in leadership in both the military and education. He was sworn in as superintendent in Manatee County on March 20th, 2013, replacing interim superintendent Dr. David Gaylor. Mr. Mills served as the chief executive officer of the Minneapolis Public Schools from July 2011 to March 2013. Prior to becoming CEO in Minneapolis, he served 10 years in Chicago Public Schools in various educational leadership positions, including 2 years as chief area officer, the area superintendent, for 26 high schools, and 3 years as area instructional officer for 6 military academy high schools. While in Chicago, Mayor Richard Daley appointed Mr. Mills chair of the Chicago Memorial Day Parade and parade and weekend from 2009 to 2011. Prior to working with Chicago Public Schools, Mr. Mills has a notable 24-year career in the United States Army, where his service assignments included cavalry squadron commander, political military officer at the United States Central Command, plans officer, United Nations Jerusalem, assistant professor, United States Military Academy, and Commander, 2nd Battalion, 5th Cavalry. He retired at the rank of Lieutenant Colonel in 2001. And his many decorations include the Legion of Merit, Ranger Tab, and Parachutist Badge. His educational background includes a Master in Business from Webster University, St. Louis, Missouri, and a Master's in National Security Affairs from the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California. Mr. Mills is married to Jessica Romando, a teacher in Chicago Public Schools, and he has a son, Michael, who is attending college in New York. So the search to find a new superintendent of schools was a difficult one, and Mr. Mills obviously has a background that prepared him well to take on the challenge that we have here in Manatee County. There are a lot of difficult choices to make to get us back on track, and I believe that the search committee absolutely made the right choice with Rick Mills. In the short time that he's been in Manatee County, he has jumped in with both feet. He's a new member of the Manatee Kiwanis, and as school superintendent, he is an ex officio member of the Manatee Chamber Board, and he's been at every meeting of both of those since he's been here. So please help me in welcoming Mr. Rick Mills.
Well, good afternoon. Exciting this morning over our district county building there with our press conference that we had this morning at 10:30, which I unveiled and released our new transition team's plan for the economic recovery of our school district as part of the 100-day entry plan that I announced prior to arriving here. So I'm going to share several things with you today, mostly a little bit about myself, how do I lead, what have I seen in the 100 days, and more importantly, how are we going to move forward as a school district around the many challenges that were released today in terms of our fiscal, business, operational, and academic side, and particularly, how are we going to implement a strategic vision and performance management and tracking and monitoring our systems as we execute our plans and look for performance around measurable goals and data and metrics that we're seeing the outcomes that we want. It's a system that I've developed over the past several years in education, started as an area superintendent to drive the performance for 26 high schools in our area, as well as being implemented in Minneapolis Public Schools as I departed there. So I've been in the county now 75 days on the job, and obviously, as if you read in the paper, making some challenging and tough decisions, and I kind of joke around that anymore today, I wonder what tie should I put on today to look good in the paper or on the TV. Anyway, it's been a challenging time, but it's been equally a rewarding time because I've heard and seen so many different things that we have in our county, in our school district, that are very necessary to move us forward in the terms of foundation. To be a great and successful school district. So my focus during these 100 days is to get out and listen and learn from all our community members. I've been out to many lunches, dinners, community events. I've been now to 50 of our schools. I've talked to every staff and faculty. I've been in their classrooms, and I've heard many of the challenges from all of the schools and staff and faculties that they wanted to share with me, they wanted to make sure that I left there with, and then I had the opportunity to connect with them a little bit about who am I, how did I get here as a superintendent, and how do I lead. So I always share with them at the end that I feel very blessed and privileged to be the superintendent of Manatee County Schools, and how happy I've been to see the great teams that we have in our schools and the great teachers and students that we have in the classrooms. So a little bit about my leadership style, if I may, and then a little bit about who I am. As in the biography, you could see from the comments that I spent 24 years in the military. I had various assignments and armor cavalry assignments, taught at West Point, served with the United Nations, served with U.S. Central Command up at MacDill Air Force Base. For 4 years, I was a political military advisor for the four-star general there for the countries of Oman, UAE, Kuwait, and Bahrain. And then I commanded a cavalry squadron. And while I commanded that cavalry squadron at Fort Knox, I met Paul Vallis, who was the CEO of Chicago Public Schools. I spent 3 days in my squadron looking at how the military uses technology and education and instruction. And at the end of the third day, he's trying to convince me to come to Chicago to work for him. And I had no plans whatsoever retiring or leaving the military at that point. I was right at the end of my first year of command. And so I did go up to Chicago about a month later. I did spend a weekend with him, got out in the schools, got out in the city, and really kind of came to the conclusion that it was a calling for me to change my focus from service to country to service to students. So a year later, I retired, changed command, went up to work for Paul, but he had left 30 days prior to go run for governor. So I ended up working for Arne Duncan for eight years and 10 years in Chicago Public Schools. And I started out at kind of a director level position and worked my way up during those 10 years to be an area superintendent of 26 schools. And we built a really great team, both in our staff, with our principals, our teacher leaders in the schools, our teachers. And we really rolled out a very, very effective educational approach to delivering results and outcomes that created great gains for us. We had six high school areas there in Chicago. I was one of the six. We had the highest performing area across the board in all metrics, closing the achievement gap, attendance, virtually every metric, we succeeded and succeeded very well. And so at that point, I decided I wanted to be a superintendent. I decided that that was my calling at this point. So I went up to Minneapolis, served as the CEO there, ran a school district across all the operations from academics to HR to finance. Did that for 21 months, got my superintendent license there, and started looking for opportunities. And at about the same timing was the opening here of the position. So I applied, and that's how I'm here today. So when I go to the schools, I always share a little bit about my leadership style with the staff and faculties in the schools. And I know it's really important to do that because you need to connect with your team and build a rapport and a trust and an understanding how we're going to come together collaboratively and inclusively to achieve that greatness that we want to do as a team in the school district. And that's also inclusive of beyond the schools, you know, our great community members and our organizations as well. So I share with them two key leadership attributes that always served me successfully over 35 years of leadership and has been the two attributes that I kind of referenced the most have been very successful for me. One, the first and foremost one is being a humble leader. It's very important to be humble as a leader and check that ego and arrogance at the door because you have to create a great team and an excellent team of organizational health and morale and trust and cohesion, and you can't do that if you lead through ego or arrogance. And so I've always considered myself to be very humble, very approachable, to connect and build teams around the fact that people don't operate in a fear environment, but they operate in an environment where they know that they can talk to their leader, have visibility on their leader, and they will see their leader throughout their organization. So I've always considered myself a humble leader. I talk to the staff and faculty, and I talk about my door is always open. I have an open door policy. You don't have to go through three doors and five people to get to me. You can make two lefts out of the fifth floor elevator and find yourself in my office because the door is always open. So I encourage them to use it. And quite frankly, in the last 70 days, it's been used quite a bit. But that's okay, because that's the kind of environment I want to create. And I don't want to have any kind of a fear concern in this district on people being able to share their candor or what they're feeling or thinking. And I want to promote that. The other attribute that I'll talk about briefly is about a relentless pursuit for excellence. I kind of come to work every day trying to do it better today than yesterday. And not only better today than yesterday, but being very positive, being very motivating, and trying to create that ambiance in your team. And always to look at ways to do it differently and more efficiently and more fiscally sound. So I've led that way over the past several years, and I can say, again, in 35 years of leadership experience plus, that I can't say I always joined a winning team, but I always left one. And so that's the idea of coming here, is create that great winning team with all of our stakeholders, all of our staff and faculties and staff at the central office, and create that greatness that we want to pursue. So in the 100-day entry plan, as I mentioned before, I want to listen and learn. I want to share about myself. I want to build on that and then move forward into the planning process. So next Tuesday, I will share what my findings have been for the first 90 days, basically, publicly. And a lot of that will coincide somewhat with what was released today in the plan by the transition team. But more importantly, what did I hear from the staff and faculty in the schools, what their concerns are, what are the challenges they see? Because this is very much aligned, and I know most folks in here probably read Good to Great. And there are two things that are always quoted out of Good to Great in Jim Collins' book. One is you got to get the right people in the right seats on the bus, which is so true. And we're doing that now in our district. We're putting the right people in the right organizational structure to create those great outcomes that we need to achieve. And then the other component of that is getting the brutal facts out to keep organizations from achieving greatness. And so very much part of this 90-100 days is to hear what the transition team sees and thinks our challenges are, as well as what I've seen in my time out in the district and in the schools, and to come collectively together and just put it out there so that everybody understands what those brutal facts are and the challenges are and how we're going to build on it and move beyond it. And you can't do that unless everybody understands the page that we're on together. And we really do have some serious challenges in our district. I get asked this question all the time, even in the staff and faculties. It surprises me, but the bottom line is I get asked the question all the time, is it worse than you really thought it was? And yes, it is. But The good news is that I'm very confident and comfortable in saying to any audience, to include our staff and faculty, that we have great teams out in the schools. We have what we need to be successful in the foundation of great teachers and staff and schools, our great students. We've got a great community that wants to get behind this. So we have all the key ingredients to be successful as a school district and move up from 47th to the higher level performing of county schools here in Florida. And I'm very confident we will achieve that, and we will achieve it quickly. So I want to get into a little bit now. I've talked about myself, a little bit about myself and my leadership style, and talk about how the vision is that we're going to move forward and how are we going to implement systems and structures and processes in place so that we're strategically aligned and we're aligning our resources around so that we're getting the most efficiencies that we need, which we sorely lack, obviously, to this point to date. So I'm going to go into the slides. I'll talk briefly about how did Rick Mills come up with this kind of five key principles of performance management. Basically two ways. One, we implemented it somewhat in the military during my time there. Ron Huberman implemented it when he was the CEO of Chicago Public Schools, but I had basically already been doing it with my schools at the time. And then I read a book by a guy named Palladino who wrote The Five Key Principles of Performance Management, read it, looked at it, digested it, and how do I take that model that he wrote and adapt it and modify it into education systems and organizations. So my team and I, over a series of few years, refined this model and created the structure I'm about to share with you that really produced those great outcomes with very minimal or nominal cost, and really does it with the team that you have in place. So first I'll talk about these five key principles. First, data, planning, alignment to plans, monitoring performance, and technology. I'll go through them briefly and kind of talk about how they need to be implemented. First and foremost, data is often, most school districts are data rich, but they're very poor in how it's used and how it translates into actions and strategies. So you have to build the capacity in any organization, particularly in education, of the utilization of data at all levels, at the district level, at the department level, at our new executive director levels that will have portfolio schools, all the way down to the schools. You have to build capacity for each organization at each leadership layer to take their data specifically focused on their organization, how they're manipulating it, how they're analyzing it, and how they're creating action plans and strategies out of it that drives instruction in the classrooms. So we were very successful in doing that. As an area superintendent, I created the capacity at my area level by creating and building data analysts that were highly trained and highly effective in using data. And then we rolled out and we trained and certified data teams in every one of our 26 schools. That then gave the schools the capacity with two or three highly trained data folks on their team to get in there, pull the data out, manipulate it, package it, and get it to the leadership teams in the schools so they could do the analysis and the instructional strategies and get it into the classroom. So first and foremost, we will, as a school district, have to do an assessment of our data capacity from the district down to the school level and build that capacity at every level so that we're using data effectively and around the decisions that we need to make around how we're going to deliver effective instruction in the classroom. The second area is planning. School districts are great for writing strategic plans, but probably not very good at executing them, and even worse, at monitoring performance around it. And so we're going to take a look at our district plan, look at how we rewrite it, and how do we build a highly effective functioning plan around measurable goals, metrics and outcomes and strategies, and how do we align our budget at the district level to meet those needs. And then after we've written that, there are school districts have about 5 to 7 core functions that they typically all do. And so academics is one component of those core functions. But in a district strategic plan, generally, there's not sufficient enough attention given to the academic portion of the plan to really drive academics in a school district. So you have to write an academic strategic plan that's very highly focused on your academic goals and outcomes that's aligned to your scorecard as a district of how you're being evaluated. I know that sounds fairly simple, but what I've seen now going into my 13th year of education seems to be totally foreign in the environment of education. So we have to write an academic plan. We have to identify measurable goals that's going to drive our district to A-level performance in the state of Florida. And what does that look like as a strategic plan? So once we write that plan, and I'm anticipating having that written this fall, I'm charging Diana Green, my new deputy for instructional services, to take the lead on that. It will also be the source document for other strategic plans in the district. So let's look at the business operations side, because in education, all roads lead to kids in the classroom. Even on the business operations side, if you look now in most school districts, you will not see a clear alignment to the business operations side to the district and academic plan. So it basically means they're operating in a silo. They're not cross-communicating. They're not cross-leveling. They're not cross-focused. So that on the business operations side, they're just doing what they think they need to do to support education, but they're not being totally aligned to the academic and to the district plan. So we have to build an academic plan and an operational plan that has alignment. Then on the academic department side, we have all those departments, and I found out going out into schools, they call that building the Palace, the Taj Mahal, in downtown. And so down there, all the academic departments have to be equally aligned to the academic plan. Otherwise, they're operating in silos, thinking they're doing what they need to be doing around their core function in supporting academics, but don't have a clear alignment of how they're aligning their strategies and goals and metrics to the academic plan, and how are they aligning their resources, more importantly, to support the overall focus for the district. So we will do that and have that in place. And then I've created these executive directors. Right now we have two directors that are providing support to schools. They're embedded in academics. They have no budget, no strategic plan, and no staff. So basically they're just functioning right now as a compliance kind of a mode, rather than a leadership role that's really driving and supporting academic achievement in their portfolio of schools. So we are creating, and we're actually interviewing right now for these new positions, that they will have a staff, they will have a budget, and they will have a strategic plan on how are they going to support their portfolio of schools that align to the academic plan. So we will create those and have that in place by next January or February. And so at that point, we will be strategically aligned to our district and academic plan in all areas of the district down to the executive director level. And then eventually we will get down to the school level. I had 26 high schools in Chicago, and every one of our schools had a five-year academic strategic plan. And that was their source document that they used to write their annual school improvement plan and to do their budgets. Why is that important? Because once you have a strategic alignment that I just outlined, everybody's aligned and focused and going in the right direction and around the same metrics and same goals. But more importantly, how are you aligning all your resources to make sure that they're all being done and used in a way that's driving performance in that alignment? So when you write these plans, you have to go through with your budget at the district level, down to all the other levels, and you have to embed your budgets in those plans so you know and identify what is it you can fund this year, what's foundational and funding that you need to fund for outlying years, and you get out of the business what we're notorious for doing in education is funding the idea of the month. And those who've been in education completely understand what I'm saying. Since you don't have any strategic alignment, you're always looking at this silver bullet curriculum, or this sounds good, or let's buy this, let's implement this. And what you really create in that environment is lack of focus on your resources, lack of focus on your professional development, lack of focus on how you're creating external partnerships and grants. We're notorious for writing a grant, getting the money, and then figuring out we have to execute it to the terms of the grant, but it's not aligned to anything we're doing. So you have to write your grants that are aligned here. In your plans, you got to know where your shortfalls are in your budget, where you run out of dollars, and how do you do external partnerships and grants that you plug into your strategic plan. We did that in Minneapolis. My executive director for external partnerships and grants took our strategic plans all the way down to that level, looked where we had our shortfalls in funding, and looked at grants and external partnerships and did that alignment so we could bring that together to create greater opportunities to fund our strategic plan. So don't quote me on this, but I know somewhere around 60-67% of organizations that failed to execute their strategic plan failed to do so because they never align their resources, their professional development training, policies, and external resources to that plan, and then therefore their plan has become ineffective. And that's across the board, not only in education, but in nonprofit organizations and companies as well. So you have to do what I just described previously, is get that alignment and put in place to your strategic plans. Here is the critical component that typically has failed to happen very well with Fidelity in education, and that is monitoring and performance. Once you write these plans, you have to have a way to measure the execution of them and know that those plans are being executed in a timely manner, and you make sure that you're utilizing resources and dollars that are being used effectively. You have to monitor that. So we've monitored in the past by doing quarterly reviews at every level, at the district level, down to the academic level, to the academic departments, to the business, down to the executive directors. I would do quarterly reviews with each one of the teams at each level to monitor their execution of their plans, then look at their metrics and their data and their outcomes around their goals to measure performance to see whether or not we were achieving the desired outcomes. But more importantly, if we weren't, were we spending dollars on programs or initiatives that weren't producing any outcomes? And I could share with you about in the last 60 days where I've already used that process to evaluate many of the things that we're doing in the school district that aren't producing outcomes. And why should we keep doing that? We should stop doing it. So this process here really drives how do you do that through quarterly reviews, through looking at the execution, looking at the performance. But then on top of that, I do monthly or twice a month performance management sessions with my teams around metrics and outcomes and goals and get into the deep dive around a particular goal or metric on what's happening and why are we not seeing the outcomes that we want and get down to the five whys and the analysis to the root cause of why we're not seeing performance and make those adjustments in an action plan that really get it moving and correct it. The last one's technology. I've come from an environment in military where they're pretty much 20 to 30 years ahead, particularly in education and how technology is being used in instruction and education. And Palladino says, and I completely agree with him, that technology is the great turbocharger for creating greater outcomes and efficiencies. And we don't use it very well in education. I will tell you, in Minneapolis and here, we have great hardware in our classrooms. But when you look at what I call the SAMR model down at the bottom, you can go online and look at it. The SAMR model says that there's four levels of using technology and that the fourth level creates the greatest outcomes and efficiencies. And that is so true. If you look at level one, you could take a word processor and you can replace it with a typewriter using the word processor. But that's only level one of using technology to its full capacity. When you get up to the level of level four in a SAMR model, which is where you're actually creating and using technology to create a new task of delivering instruction, then you've exponentially used technology to its fullest capacity. And there are many, many organizations out there getting to that level. I can tell you the military's at that level right now. So I'm not going to get too much in detail, but every organization has to have a theory of management of how do you want to drive outcomes and achievement, and first and foremost, how do you build leadership capacity in your organization? I can tell you again, 35 years of leadership experience, leadership is the center of gravity of any organization and being a great organization. And so how do you build that capacity in a school district and how do you increase the capabilities around that is very much essential to the success of any school district. And again, I've got 35 years of doing that. I just want to share a little vignette with you. I'm a voracious reader of books in leadership, education, and management and business. I've read the book probably 15 or 20 times, The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership by John Maxwell. And John Maxwell talks about the law of the lid being the first law, and it's LID. And he says that the law of the lid is that an organization will never be able to achieve a performance level above its leadership. So on a scale of 10, if your leadership team is a 5 or 6, your organization will never rise above a 5 or 6 performance because that leadership will put a lid on the organization and keep it at that level. So he talks about in his book, under that law, about two brothers in the 50s in the San Bernardino Valley that opened up a very successful chain of restaurants, the drive-up concept, walk-up window eventually, and they decided to try to franchise this, and they failed. Then he went back and added more restaurants and were successful, had a good quality of life, and they decided to try to franchise it again, and they failed a second time. And this time they just said, we're just going to stick with what we're good at. Then he met a gentleman who sold milkshake machines and had a small company, and he partnered with these brothers, and he convinced them to allow them to help them realize their goal and their vision of franchising their chain of restaurants nationally and internationally. And he was very successful in doing that and helping these brothers achieve what's modern day today, McDonald's. And the guy we're talking about is Ray Kroc. And Ray Kroc was a 10 liter. And Dick and Maurice McDonald, they were 6'5", 6 liters. They didn't even know it. But given the fact they didn't know they were 5 or 6 liters, they were never going to get to the 9-10 level. They were never going to be able to take their restaurants to the level that Ray Kroc did as a 10 liter. So leadership's essential. I talked about planning. We're going to move forward with that. I would like to talk a bit about curriculum mapping. There are 4 standards of instruction that are used commonly in delivering instruction. I can tell you, being in 50 schools, we're not delivering instruction the same in one classroom to another, let alone one school to another. And having been out there, talked to the principals, et cetera, I've confirmed that. So we have to move forward as a school district. How do we want to deliver instruction in the classroom that's consistent and uniformed across the district, but still leaves teachers the autonomy to deliver their instruction in their classrooms? So we have to move forward in doing that. And the best way to do that is to map your curriculum to the benchmark standards in terms of pacing and rigor. And how do you implement RTI intervention strategies? How do you implement special education strategies? How do you implement ESOL strategies into those maps? How are you staying on pace during the school year, both horizontally and vertically and grade level? So you map your curriculum, and we in Chicago mapped our entire high school curriculum in 26 schools in 15 months. And we did it on Atlas Rubicon. And there is an area superintendent, when we were done, I could go in any curriculum map online in any one of my schools, look at any core or content or course, and see those maps, see the pacing and the rigor. Were we on track? Were we implementing strategies to make adjustments around what we're seeing around the data and the metrics? And I was very comfortable and confident that we were using mapping the right way to drive outcomes of instruction. Execution and monitoring, I've already talked about. Assessments, we have to be consistent on how we're using assessments. A lot of school districts tend to use the annual summative assessment by the state as a way to measure performance for the school, but you can't wait a whole year to make adjustments. So you have to have some way to use formative assessments every 10 or 12 weeks to measure the growth performance of your students so you can make adjustments in the classrooms and not wait a whole year to figure and find out that what you were doing wasn't working. So we have to look and see how we want to do that as a school district. And then the last one, how do we focus on those classrooms and how do we want to deliver instruction? And then more importantly, how are we going to teach or use instruction to teach the higher order thinking skills that students will now be challenged with the new Common Core as it's rolled out? We have to find a way to start teaching higher order thinking skills because that's what students will be measured and assessed by on the Common Core assessments. About 5 or 6 years ago, I went in and met my 26 principals, put on a whiteboard. Here's the circle of the principal. Here's the great teachers in your classroom. What do you have between that in terms of leadership and instruction to drive outcomes and success? And I got kind of the blank stare, and I asked them to take out a piece of paper and draw what that would look like in their schools on how are they using assessment and data, and how is it actually affecting teaching in the classroom. And for those who wrote some kind of a model, I asked them to look on the left or right. Was it the same? And it wasn't. First of all, I had pretty much blank papers, and second of all, those who did, it didn't match at all. But wouldn't it make sense that if you use assessment and data and metrics, that you have a systematic approach that gets down to the changing and modifying instruction in the classroom, and what are those strategies, and who's driving that? So we created instructional leadership teams in all 26 of our schools that were focused on using metrics and data across the curriculum, and then how they were making decisions on that to make instructional changes in their classrooms. And then we implemented professional learning communities that were by grade level and by content area that had a more specific focus on their teachers, their sections, and their individual students. We did that in the first year. We had significant gains. But then I would say that the second year, I saw our ILTs and PLCs using data too much, crunching it and spending too much time on it, and not enough on the analysis and the instructional strategies. So we created those data teams and trained them and certified them so they could do that. I'll just finish and close by saying this system here really had the greatest impact on achieving outcomes of our students in the classroom, closing our achievement gap and increasing our gains on ACTs and PSAEs. And it really, really was a home run per se in education. So I'm gonna open it up for questions.
Rick, thank you very much. Great presentation. And we will take a few minutes for questions and answers, and it is being taped by METV. So if you have a question, I would ask you, please come up to the microphone so we can make sure that we get it all recorded. So we have Dr. Connor with our first question.
Mr. President, I'd like to mainly make an observation, if I may. I mean, in listening to our new superintendent, it's obvious how fortunate we are that our paths met during this national search. But we'd be remiss in this setting not to point out that our committee and one of the most influential components of that committee in the selection of our superintendent was our own John Horn. And John, I'd like to just publicly say thank you so much for your dedication.
Well, could I also add my thanks to John Horn, too? Thank you, John.
Does anyone else have a question?
Any other questions, please?
Are you glad you took the job?
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for this discussion today. It's given me a lot of hope into our future as for Manatee County Schools. As an educator, I was victim to a former educator, victim to a lot of those new ideas and crunching it, throwing it at us in the classroom and having the teachers have to implement them. And I don't want the teachers today to feel that way about what's going to transpire over the next 15 months. Or what have you. So how do you tell that classroom teacher you're still going to be able to use your personality and your techniques while also implementing these new strategies, these new core curriculums, so to say? How do you encourage them and so that you're not taking them over with just a canned new thing, new perspective on teaching?
That's a great question. First and foremost, you have to be able to share the vision, but people have to believe in who you are as a leader before they're going to believe in your vision. Part of the 50 school visits that I've had, and I'll finish the rest this week, has been very much about talking about this and sharing with it and seeing the alignment of the staff and faculty in the schools around addressing the very issues that they see challenges with. They get real excited when they hear you're going to lay out a five-year vision and you're not going to throw at them a different thing every year or so. That you're going to lay out professional development 12 to 18 months out instead of what's the professional development this month, where we're wasting their time in professional development, doesn't make any rhyme or reason of what they're doing in the classrooms. So they're excited about it. I've been in 50 schools. I share this with them in part, told them I will more in detail next week, but they're very excited about it.
Thank you for being here. Patrick Roth, City Council. Coming from Minnesota, how do you, you're coming under state guidelines, you're rebuilding our school district, you know, but you're also going to be operating with state guidelines, and you're coming from the Minnesota area. And how do you find the guidelines with what you're now facing with the state of Florida?
I don't really see any challenges around how we're going to move forward. As a school district, this is my third state now and being in different statutes in education and different school districts in terms of the state requirements. I haven't seen anything yet that's going to be a challenge around how we're moving forward with. Very excited about the $22 million in the teacher salary increase. I just announced today that all of our employees will get an increase this summer, not just our teachers as part of that state funding. But I haven't seen anything so far looking at state statutes or anything around it would be prohibitive of moving forward with this.
And on that same note, core curriculum has, some people are very excited about it, some people are nervous about it. I know my wife's an educator and she likes the idea of core curriculum. How do you feel on that?
Well, Common Core is adopted by 45 states, and it's a Common Core with shared benchmarks and rigor and pacing that's shared among all the states instead of each state having their own core curriculum and their own benchmark assessment. So the 45 states around that, you will have virtually alignment vertically and horizontally throughout the school years, throughout the outlying years, K through 12, that's aligned across the country on how you're seeing pacing and rigor and the benchmarks so that everybody's on the same pace around those. So I'm very excited about it. It's what I did in Chicago. Many of my schools, when we mapped our curriculum, went to Common Core immediately because we were going to be implementing it.
Thank you. And thank you for sharing your strategy with us today. It was very interesting to hear all these details. Can you please tell us how long you feel it's going to be before we start to see the positive results of this plan and what we could expect to see first and second and so on?
Good question. At the executive director school level, we are going to move forward with those school leadership teams and the data team that will really get into the schools and have those meetings and sessions around looking at assessments and data and metrics and having those discussions across the curriculum down to the content and grade level. We're going to implement that as soon as possible starting this fall. The strategic planning alignment should be pretty much done by next March down to the executive director level. And I'm going to give the schools a year to write their strategic plans so they can kind of adjust to it. So we should be strategically aligned by the fall, about 18 months from now.
Anyone else have another question? Okay, that being said.
Thank you
very much. Great presentation, and I want to mention that Superintendent Mills has been here for 75 days, and he got all this done in 75 days. So I think by the end of the year, he's going to have it all wrapped up. We'll be good to go. I want to mention to you that you all know that the Chamber has taken a position on the E-date, the tax exemption amendment, and also on the half-cent sales tax. And we have information on both of those issues on the table, so please educate yourselves and get out there and vote on these important issues and pick up some information if you'd like to learn more about that. And thank you all very much for coming today.